Good afternoon, church. How are you doing? It's the Lord's Day, the 17th of July in the year of 2022, and the sixth Sunday after Pentecost. With so many things going around us, let us realize that God's still in control, for He deserves our worship. Our call to worship is from the book of Psalm, chapter 52, verse 8 to 9. But I am like a green olive tree in the house of God. I will thank you forever. In the presence of the people, I will proclaim your name. Let us worship him.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord God, thank you for this wonderful day. We are here today to honor you, to thank you, to praise you, and to put your name on high. You are our Lord and our Savior, our King. Thank you, Lord, for all the blessings and all the protection that you have given to us in our daily life. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity that we can gather and celebrate your day. We ask for your forgiveness for all our sins and our unrighteousness. Bless each one of us, Lord, as we are here this afternoon. We ask for your Holy Spirit to give us wisdom and guide us in our worship celebration. Bless our speaker whom delivering your message today. Open our hearts and open our minds through your words. Inspire us as we learn more about your ways. Be with us today, Lord. We ask this in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. With Paul's exhortation to the Ephesians, let this be ours too, as we offer him our song of praise.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart, yeah. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, 'cause it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, 'cause it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. All about you.
Good afternoon po, Pasadena Yemlig Church, and welcome our online worship service this afternoon. It has been a wonderful week for us as a family because we have been praying for the longest time about our coming there, and God answered our prayers and to come and worship with you guys. He's one of the on top of the prayer list. Like, ooh, oh, kamusta po kayong lahat? And how is your weekend? I hope we can tell here the details of what we have been through. But That is for the later time. You know, my wife and I have been praying to God for wisdom and discernment for the last week that has passed. But we let God be in control of the situation. And we really felt His guidance and wisdom this week. And we were given discernment as we answer questions that will either make or break our application. But all throughout, God made it happen. And all glory, God alone. Our theme for today is about discernment. Discernment and our Christian response. How do we find true discernment from God and His guidance from the Holy Spirit? What is discernment in the first place? And how do we know our discernment is right? No, discernment is the ability to perceive sights that are scripturally guided by the Holy Spirit. So in order to respond in a Christian manner, we need to have proper discernment from God to respond appropriately in matters that are true and honorable. In Romans chapter 15, verse 4, which is our main text, and I took this from the NET Bible translation. And here is what it says. For everything that was written in former times was written for our instruction, so that through endurance and through encouragement of the scriptures, we may have hope. So the Bible is our guide, and it was written for our instruction so that we may have hope this lifetime. So whatever was written in the former days was written for our instruction and guidance. And the Bible is our sole guide and principle in any matters concerning our lives. Now, some will disagree, but if only they knew the kind of life and experience we are having, do you think people will want it? Yes, of course they do. For if they only knew the kind of life and relationship I have or we have with the Lord, I'm sure they will want it for themselves. So, but why they wouldn't like to bother with our life stories? You know, that's because sometimes we are afraid to share them what is going, especially, you know, the embarrassing ones in our lives. But I am forgetting that we are also sinners. And so just like them, you know, the difference is that we have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And when we read Psalms chapter 19, verse 1, this gives us hope that there is a creator who made all these things around us. Psalms 19, verse 1 says, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky displays His handiwork. So that's one of clues or very subtle information that we can prove that there is a God, no? So let's go to our first point regarding discernment. When we discern the worldview with our Christian lenses or context. So in order to discern with a Christian perspective, we must contextualize what worldview we should be in. Ano ba yung culture natin, no? Yung pinagagalingan natin. So, in our culture, we know how to spot truth from falsehood. Sa Christian culture natin, there are three things that I would like to share with you this afternoon. And I would like to share my experiences with this. So number one, in discerning the worldview, we discern with scripture and literacy. Now, I always remember, even when I was in elementary, my interest in the Word of God is already there. I used to have Bible comics and Christian literatures kept, and I always read them. During my elementary days, my classmates will volunteer me to compete to Bible quizzes, and I usually won them. Lagi akong sinasabihang, Pastor, because of the way I dress. Bata pa lang ako, no? That's the yung alias na binibigay sa akin. Because they know that I am a pastor's kid. And I remember how I was proud to beat some of the brightest in our school when Bible is concerned. You know, I can beat students from the first section whom I knew because they were my classmates. And so they knew that I can beat them because I'm a pastor's kid. And this is a Christian school where most of the students that are studying our pastor's kids as well from UMC and UCCP. And they are being beaten by a Yemeni pastor's kid. And after college, I enrolled in a seminary. And that's where I learned that I'm not really that Bible literate. No? I still have many things to learn. Next is the academic skills. So I did not know academic skills are that important until I went to seminary. My goal back then was just to be and like any regular average student. Finish school and start looking for a job that will help me earn some money. And I was somewhat misguided to that belief that I was to finish finish school in a practical sense and do and find a job that I can earn some money for myself and for my future family. No, I was not born in an academic family. My father used to tell me that he finished college in a span of 10 years because he was a working student, my father. And then my mom only finished high school and started working at an early age. And so the mindset that was passed to me was, if you want to have a name for yourself, you must earn it. Huh? Next is our walk with God. So how is your walk with God? You know, my serious walk with God began when I was in college as well. I attended a one-month student camp where I was mentored by staff campers on how to do quiet time, spending solitude with God, meeting other students, and learning from them as well. And so whenever walking with God is brought up, I always remember footprints in the sand. Okay? Footprints in the sand. Let me see if I have... That image of footprints in the sand. This poem with the picture, this is actually the very same picture I used to read on my lolo and lola's house in Laguna. And that's the first place I saw and read the poem. It was a lovely and encouraging poem to read. And let me read that to you, no? Footprints in the sand. One night, I dream a dream. I was walking along the beach with my Lord. Across the dark sky flashed scenes from my life. For each scene, I noticed two sets of footprints in the sand, one belonging to me and one to my Lord. When the last scene of my life was shot before me, I looked back at the footprints in the sand, and there was only one set of footprints. I realized that this was at the lowest and saddest times of my life. And this always bothered me. And I questioned the Lord about my dilemma. Lord, you told me when I decided to follow you, you would walk and talk with me all the way. But I'm aware that during the most troublesome times of my life, there is only one set of footprints. I just don't understand why. When I need you most, believe me. He whispered, my precious child, I love you and will never leave you. Never, ever. During your trials and testings, when you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried. Now we know that our walk with God is not easy, but there will come trials along the way. So we need to test every spirit whenever we have the chance to do so. And in the footprints, you will notice there that the relationship that the person had with the Lord was really close, and that will only be possible if you have spent quiet time with God and listening to His subtle voices. So we need to have discernment in our relationships. But I would like to ask you to refer to 1 John 4:1 about testing the spirits to determine false prophets that have gone into the world. Now, number two, we have to determine in our discernment in our relationships. You know, the more you love the roses, the more you love the thorns. We forget most of the time the thorns in the roses, that we were probably pricked with thorns once in our life. How do we discern love in our relationships? One of the challenges some people have with relationship is the expression of love. They find it corny, or they were not used to PDA or HHWW. If you know what the meaning of that, because that's not their personality. We find it easier to love our close relatives and friends, and we will not initiate or proactively love another person. The differences we have. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 20, anyway, I have here a picture of a rose. The more you love roses, the more you must bear with thorns. Okay. So 1 John chapter 4, verse 20, it says, if anyone says, I love God, and yet hates his fellow Christian, he is a liar, because the one who does not love his fellow Christian, whom he has seen, cannot love God, he has not seen. That is in NET translation. So our lives revolve around relationships in the church, family, business or work, and even politics. So this is something we need discernment of. Number three, discernment to live moral and grateful lives. Now, living grateful lives is due to saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it requires moral distinction from the rest. That is why the two, moral and gratefulness, is the perfect combination for discernment. We are grateful to the Lord because we are saved. And so we are not supposed to live in misery. When we know that we are grateful God for saving us from sins, then that's when we live moral lives. The thing is, we try to impress God with our moral lifestyle, but God said no need to impress, because do not. When we impress God with morality, He knows that is not something that we need to brag about. You know, people see Christianity as just a moral thing and a set of values to follow, just like the Ten Commandments. But what they are forgetting is Christianity is based on relationships. In Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 to 3, it says, "Therefore, be imitators of God, as dearly loved children, and live in love, just as Christ also loved us and gave himself for us a sacrificial and fragrant offering to God. But among you, there must not be either sexual immorality, impurity of any kind, or greed, as these are not fitting for the saints." So you see there that God called us as his dearly loved children, and we need to live love. So yes, there is morality in this verse, but there is also relationship emphasized in love, as Christ loved us and sacrificed for our salvation. Number four is our natural or common discernment of things. This is the process of learning to live in the world, but not of the world. Now, some people say, common sense is not a gift. It's punishment, because you have to deal with everyone who doesn't have it. This is more like a humor. No? Well, you can only feel that you are being punished if you know that you have, if you have common sense. But if you don't have it, then you will not feel it, no? So this is just a joke. But jokes are meant to be told, because somewhat there's truth. And so sometimes you meet people where they are really smart, and we might say geniuses, or probably a bookworm, reads a lot of information, but fails in simple decision making when they are expected to decide on something. Now, in the Luke chapter 16, verse 9, is a wise saying of our Lord Jesus Christ on how to live in this world. Says, "And I tell you, make friends for yourselves, how you use worldly wealth, so that when it runs out, you will be welcomed into eternal homes." So make use of what you have, resources of what you have, to make friends with others. Probably if they need anything from you, probably can lend some money. And Luke 16, verse 11 says, "If then you haven't been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, he'll entrust you with the true riches." So what Jesus is saying here is true riches is not found in this world. We should learn to live not of this world, but of the world to come. Number five is our vocational or calling discernment. This is the process of asking God to direct your life and your identity in Him. So what is your calling in this life? You may still be praying to God what to do and how to do your calling, but one may provide a hint on what is God's calling for you. God's call on your life often disrupt your plans and take you to places you might not want to go. God will call you out of your comfort zone to do things that you might not be prepared or think in your life. Sometimes we think that we are not qualified to do this task, but God will qualify you in order to do wonderful things for His glory. That's one of the quote that I would like to share. God's call on your life will often disrupt your plans and take you to places you might not want. In Romans chapter 11, verse 29, it says, "For the gifts and the call of God are irrevocable." So you cannot, when God has given you a gift, cannot say, "No, I wouldn't accept it." But that's a gift. So you have to accept it. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1, it says there that being an apostle of Christ is by the will of God. So our calling is the will of God. So many of us are asking whether we are called by God. What calling is He going to give us? And what kind of ministry are we called in? Another type of discernment is discernment of spirits. Discernment of spirits. Do you remember when Jesus said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan"? So we have to remember that there's demonic influences in ideas, people, and organizations. And this is when Peter was, he gave in to a demonic spirit that he said something that will disrupt the plan and will of God through Jesus Christ. That's a picture of when Jesus Christ told him in Mark 8:33 is this, "But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, 'Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of me.'" So we have to be discerning of the Spirit. And last type of discernment is gender discernments. I know that this is a sensitive topic, but it needs to be addressed based on the Word of God and in what it is saying. So part of Christian discernment is the gender role identity based on the Word of God. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, it says there, "So God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created male and female, created them." So question is, how do we respond to people having different pronouns from different from what they were born? And of course, that's as a Christian, we are somewhat traditional in our perspective based on what the Bible is saying. And there were some Christians who are embracing the liberal approach when it comes to gender because God loves them as well. So we have to be somewhat in what is the Bible is saying. That's where we have to really embrace. So this afternoon, Let us pray that God will give us discernment and our respond to the worldview of others will be Christian with the leading of the Holy Spirit. God bless you po, Pasadena Yemenite Church, and may God take good care of you wherever you are.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a prepare me. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a
Our sending port is from the book of Colossians, chapter 1, verse 27 to 28. God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you. It is He whom we proclaim, warning everyone, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful afternoon given us. Thank you for the gift of discernment and the wise knowledge that you're continually giving us through your word. We thank you, Lord, for your continued guidance through us, through the Holy Spirit. And we thank you for each and every one of us for giving us this camaraderie, brotherhood, and sisterhood in Christ, that we have a community where we can get some advice as well in terms of situations that we are currently in. And so we thank you, Lord, for the gift of discernment, and we pray that you continually give us wisdom, knowledge, as we continue with our Christian lives along the way. As we end, may the blessing of the Holy Spirit be felt among each and every one of us. Now, to Him who is able to keep you from falling, to present you without fault and with great joy, the only God, our Savior, Jesus Christ, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now and forevermore. Amen.